open search capabilities to explore this. It opens up new ways in which, in fact, discovery and search can coexist. And in fact, it's a continuum between discovery and search. But the thing that is common among all of this is the web as an architecture. And what we're seeing in a very quiet way, and one that I think we need to be a little bit more aware of, is what I would characterize as the identifier wars. So, take it a little bit back to history. The phrase browser wars, resonate with anyone? It was a horribly bloody time. It was terrible tragedies occurred. It was horrible. The point is, different browser manufacturers were trying to compete, and people were trying to basically compete for mindshare. And that was an important part of defining sort of the future of how the web evolved. After the browser wars, in fact, we had what was generally referred to as the search engine wars, which was also bloody, but at a certain level, quieter in terms of its bloodiness. But in fact, actually, at a certain level as well, we the consumers win in this, right? Because what we're seeing is a tremendous amount of, really amazing advances in search technology that we the consumers are sort of taking advantage of, which is actually, very interesting in that regard. But it was a very, very interesting time of consolidation and normalization and, some large degree of nastiness. What I believe is what's happening very quietly right now is what I would characterize as the identifier wars. When I say I like Albert Einstein, and we recognize that basically we have different identifiers for Albert Einstein, which identifier I use for Albert Einstein actually becomes a very important one to consider. By liking Albert Einstein, like 28 million people do in Facebook, that's a different identifier than what Google Knowledge Graph's version of Albert Einstein is. And frankly, that's a different identifier than VOP or ID.lock.gov or any other authority service that we in the library community might be coming up with. The reason that these discovery and search engine platforms are trying to get these identifiers out there and have people link to them is because the more people that link to them, the more they understand the context in which people relate. The more valuable services they create, the more targeted advertising they can create, the more business intelligence can be gleaned. Which is all actually quite good until we realize how that data may or may not be used. But once we learn that, it's too late. So it's not, from an underlying standards technology standpoint, the ability of providing identifiers and have people link to that is actually a really powerful one. What's happening right now is a bit of a an accelerant, trying to figure out, get them to link to me. And this is, again, a nice little diagram that tries to basically explain an extraordinarily powerful but complicated way in which the web actually works in terms of relevance ranking. This is called PageRank. Basically, it says the value of a particular resource is proportionate to the number of things that link to it. So the more things that link to me, the more valuable I am. And this is, in fact, actually how Facebook at a certain level does its graph search, and how Google does its relevant ranking, and how, frankly, search engines general basically deliver results based on, in essence, not really the markup, even though that's an important part of it, but the linkages that exist between these things. And I need to turn this off. And what's happening right now is in this context of the identifier wars and this identifier landscape, the things that are easy to link to win. And the things that are trusted, this actually is, that's, for those that can't see that, that little small bottom box is trust. And frankly, that's too big for this slide. Easy wins in this space. If it's easier to link to something, that you will. If I have to basically dig hard to link to something, I won't. In essence, which identifiers I link to is an artifact of how easy it is to basically link to them. And Google and Facebook right now are making it extraordinarily easy to link to things. We in the library, museum, and archive community are making it actually quite difficult to link to things. I'm getting ahead of myself. I'll talk a little bit about that as well. So let me flip now. I talked a little bit about the visible web. Now I can talk a little bit about the invisible web. The invisible web, in short, is the library community. Sorry, that's us. We actually have a tremendous amount of information that is, in fact, just simply not viewable by the web. That can't be news to us, and yet it still seems to be. But what folks have actually done, and this is actually quite important to recognize, is sort of taking a step back and saying, look, not only are library standards not on the web, but they're not of the web. And in fact, by weaving the future of library standards into the very fabric of the web, we can actually increase visibility and discovery of the things that we curate. And we can actually accelerate that curation in ways that, frankly, we just haven't been able to see those kinds of economies of scale otherwise. So I'm not going to go into a huge discussion on BibFrame. You're going to basically hear about that in other sessions later in this conference. But I want to highlight a few key points that are important in this discussion of the visible and invisible web. So first and foremost, we talk about BibFrame in a bibliographic framework. But the reality is we're trying to basically design something that literally is both capturing the content in which we've created over the past 40 years, but to go back to the early Delta Core discussion, flexible enough that it can evolve for the next 40 years as well. That's no easy task. We're not talking about libraries. We're talking about the larger memory organization space. When my child has a report to do on Abraham Lincoln, he is not thinking about going to the library to find information about that, and the archive, and the museum. Guess what? He's thinking about Google. Right? The institutional boundaries that we have around memory organizations are artificial to the users we serve. And the ability to break those barriers down is what this is trying to do. And finally, and most importantly, and perhaps most unclearly, again, not just using the web as a delivery mechanism, but being very much of the web. That's a very important distinction, and it is very unclear. But in short, it's about using the web identifiers, using the way the web talks as a way of representing the data that we in the library, museum, and archive community are curating. So in the context of those Legos, if you go to the BibFrame site, one way of characterizing what's being developed there is just a whole bunch of Legos. And there's a lot of them, because basically trying to represent a lot of the past 40 years is kind of painful. MARC as a standard has been one of the longest, it has been the longest, interchange standard of any industry. It has grown, it has adapted, it has morphed, it's grown a third arm. I mean, it has basically done things because the community has basically done this. And it's reached a point where, in fact, it's not evolving in an effective and efficient way. But trying to basically think about how to reflect that in the web is a non-trivial task. And BibFrame is an attempt to basically take on that non-trivial task. Of the various different standards and the various different drafts and the various different documents and thoughts around there, one of these is related to the discussion at hand, and one of the things that I think actually the Dublin Core can help significantly move forward. And this is this notion of being able to take subsets of those Legos and do interesting things with them. In fact, we don't need to basically have all the Legos to build interesting shapes. We just need to be very clear about some of the shapes that we're interested in. And the profile work can be thought of as sort of taking parts of those Legos and assembling them in small, digestible, useful shapes in a way that very specialized, very specific communities can benefit from. Now, I'm not going to basically tell you which one of these things might be REA, Angry Bird. Which one of these things might be simpler than others. which one of them might be more useful than others. What I'm trying to say is that, in fact, we can take some of these building blocks and assemble them for very specific uses and connect to the people that basically need it, rather than trying to sort of game the system, which is our current status quo in terms of Zerg's status quo, in terms of MARC. And the profile work that basically is being discussed in BidFrame is directly built on the profile work that was basically being discussed 14 years ago from Dublin Core. If anything, the way I would characterize it is actually the profile work in BidFrame is actually more relaxed. It's less about constraints. It's less about validation. It's more about packaging. And frankly, packaging, best practices, consensus goes a long way in terms of consistency. Guess what? MARC has no validation inside of it. So BidFrame profiles gives us a common model. BidFrame gives us a common model to start doing this. And one of the things I want to sort of make a point about BidFrame as a common model, for 2 months prior to designing BidFrame, we looked around at all of the linked data implementations that different national libraries, regional libraries, museums, archives, etc. were doing. We queried APIs, we looked at the patterns inside of the data, we tried to do frequency distribution over the vocabularies we were using, we tried to see if we were identifying common patterns. Guess what? The only common pattern that we could really identify was that everyone called it linked data. Dublin Core was used a lot in terms of its namespace, but the consistency in which Dublin Core was used, there was none. DC Creator had a range of a URI. DC Creator had a literal. DC Creator had a literal that inside of it had HTTP colon dot 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 dot. Right. So trying to build systems that combine this information, they were all linked data, but they were all not linkable. So part of what we were trying to do in BidFrame is identify those things that were common patterns, not introducing new patterns, but could we identify common patterns across these things? As a way of sort of saying, look, there's been a lot of precedence and a lot of work. Can we come up with a common way in which we could map from what we're existing doing to the minimal subset, then start combining this together and build off of the network effect in which libraries, museums, and archives actually have a huge possibility of leading? So we might not like some of the design patterns in BidFrame. We might not like BidFrame at all. I know some of you don't. But the point is that we need to get past this, because what's at stake is too important. We need to figure out ways in which we can take some of these principles and take some of these patterns and reflect our data in a way that maximizes their use. And that's what these blueprints do. So I want to talk briefly about a project that we did with the National Library Board of Singapore and how this fits together. And this is my poor attempt at basically describing this. But it's similar for those that are familiar with cascading style sheets with BidFrame profiles. The notion here is, in the context of the National Library Board of Singapore, what we were tasked to do was, can you come up with a linked data architecture that integrates all of our stuff? And everyone basically, you know, that's a challenging problem, especially in that context where the National Library Board of Singapore now basically has the National Museum and the National Archives as part of its institutional ownership. So in essence, how do you basically make it possible to tie together monographs, serials, music, rare books, videos, archives, images, etc., etc., all which basically surprisingly have different data formats, and all which surprisingly have different data standards? And can we magically make this into one possible system that we can deliver effective services and solutions to our users? Sounds fun. It's actually really tough. So part of the approach that we did to try and solve this is we went back to some of the principles of the Dublin Core, the Warwick framework, the Singapore framework, the notion of building these modules of descriptive assets and basically combining them and their declarative mappings in a way that we could actually use and map things together. And it came out actually, I mean, from a validation point of the importance of the Warwick framework and the Singapore framework, you know, this is only one example, and you can't draw any conclusion from this. But the notion of being able to take a set of Legos that represent a bib frame light,